Midweek, Wednesday, the 11th day in the month of March 2020. Thank you very much for joining us this morning on the platform. This is the pinnacle of all discussions, where we take a look at issues, in-depth analysis at issues as it affected their nation, Nigeria, and also as it affected their state, Abia State. It is still the part of the morning show, you know, our morning show. We call it Morning Spies, and this is the discussion segment. My name is Michael Oni. Now, this morning, we're taking a look at the dethronement of the Emir of Kano, Muhammad Sanusi II. There is a new Emir, anyways, as we relate it with the role of traditional rulers in politics. That's what we're taking a look at this morning. And joining me on the conversation this morning is Uche Agoru. He's a journalist and also a public affairs analyst. Good morning to you, Uche.
Yeah, good morning, Michael. Good morning, listeners.
It's good to have you join me this morning on this side of the show. You know, we have a gathering later in the evening.
Call it
the State of the Nation. And of course, we will be reaching across to someone there in Kano just to have a feel of what the masses, what the feeling is like there in Kano. We will be reaching across to someone there later on. But let's give you a background of what happened that led to the dethronement of the Emir, talking about Muhammad Sanusi, His Highness now, not His Royal Highness, because he has been dethroned. Now, the palace staff had missed fillings. That was on Sunday in the evening, the start of the week, when an invitation came for the Emir, Muhammad Sanusi II, to attend a meeting at the government house on Monday morning. Nobody knew what the subject of the meeting would be, but the invitation on Sunday, the March 8, resembled one received by Mr. Sanusi's grandfather, Emir Muhammad Sanusi, 57 years ago. The then influential Emir had fallen out of favor with the powers in Kaduna, then headquarters of the Northern Region government, after a controversial and bitter investigation into the finances of the emirate led by a British administration, David Muffet. The old Emir was invited to Kaduna. It was a journey of no return. Unbeknown to the Emir, a letter for his resignation was on the table of the then governor of Northern Region, Kashim Ibrahim, who he was asked to see on arrival in Kaduna. The Emir was made to resign on account of Muffet report and was immediately exiled to Azare in present Bauchi State. Well, exactly 57 years ago, you heard the story of what happened. Now, the same thing repeated itself, but in a different way this time around. Deliberate actions and subconscious ones, Sanusi II wanted to be a reincarnation of his grandfather. First, he styled his name after that of his grandfather by changing his non-formal name, Sanusi Lamido Sanusi, to Muhammad Sanusi II. He borrowed the grandfather's unique turban style, among other palace practices. Now, Mr. Sanusi also wanted more. The grandfather was a famed, tough monarch. He was influential and iron-fisted. He could afford as a man in control of the rich Kano native authority and a close confidant of the Premier of Northern Nigeria. As someone coming freshly from confronting the President of Nigeria as a CBN governor, Mr. Sanusi wanted to bring the same censure and passion to the Emirate throne. Well, within a short time, a man who appointed him to the throne, the then governor Rabiu Kwankwaso, would query him twice. Many observers feared a fate of his grandfather for him from the early days, but it has happened now. There was a probe was brought in, complications in the relationship between two leaders in Kano, talking about the governor and also the Emir. At the end of the day, he was dethroned this week, not forgetting when the once flourishing Kano Emirate was splitted into five, with additional first-class emirs in two other emirates, Bichi, Gaya, Rano, and Karaye. So these are many other things so we'll be taking a look at this morning on the program. Uche, how did you receive the news? A first-class Oba, so to speak, a traditional ruler, dethroned by the government, by the governor of the state. How did you receive the news?
first of all, I must be very frank here. I wasn't surprised.
Okay.
I had long expected it. You see,
you long expected it.
I long expected his dethronement.
Okay.
Given what has played out all along between the deposed Emir Sanusi,
okay,
and the Ganduja administration, the love lost was not did not even start from the Ganduja administration. I think it dated back to Kwankwaso.
Kwankwaso, who and, appointed him?
Who appointed him? You know, as the Emir, as against this guy that is now the substantive Emir, the Ado Bayero. What happened was, from if you look at it very well, I think Ganduje endured the what he perceived as the excesses of Sanusi Lamido Sanusi Muhammad II to a very large extent, because under Kwankwaso he received four queries.
Yes,
he received four queries. People should know this. People should also remember that it was Kwankwaso that appointed him as the Emir. And under him, he received four queries. So that means there has been a distrust. There has been a dislocation. There has been the relationship between him and the former governor of Kano State wasn't that rosy, despite the fact that he appointed him. The under Ganduje, Ganduje has only given him only one query in 5 years under Ganduje. Remember, Kwankwaso was 4 years.
Yes.
But under Ganduje, in 5 years, Ganduje has only issued one query to him, meaning that Ganduje had tolerated him for a long time and now had to take the extreme measure. But that apart, I think the Sanusis have a history of radicalism.
Okay.
Whether positive or negative radicalism.
So, are you saying the history of radicalism might have contributed to him being dethroned as a traditional ruler?
It cannot be far away from what caused the dethronement. That history of radicalism, like the history of the great grandfather, who was also dethroned. So, though the issue surrounding the dethronement of the great grandfather was not very clear to us. As at this moment, we don't really know what transpired.
Will you say being outspoken is a radicalism? Because many comments on economic policies at various times, the dethroned traditional ruler has criticized the federal and state government policies.
Yes, across
even board. Right in front of the governor in
across
some public banks.
At a point, he was invited by the governor's forum. Governors forum where all governors were seated, he there and then criticized them. So he's not criticizing the northern governors.
So will you tag this as radicalism?
Yes. Now listen to me. Now if you had my
analysis,
I said negative or positive radicalism.
Okay.
You understand? You know, there are radicalisms that are the negative. There are some that are in the positive as well. Understand? Ganduje had displayed to some people what he was saying is against their belief, but to the masses, to a great extent, to the people, to a very large extent, they love what Ganduje was saying. Ganduje was being correctional. If you also listen to the spokesman, that is the Commissioner of Information, Kano State, he alluded to this fact, but then he said that the way Amanahe was carrying it out was the issue. That he had access, unhindered, unfettered access to the governor.
So
that he would have gone to the governor and tabled all his misgivings about certain issues.
It can be a way of being transparent, if you ask me.
The Kano State is making was that, in line with that, is their radicalism. To them, it is negative.
Okay.
He's bringing negative publicity to their government. He's bringing bad blood. He's bringing, but he is inciting. In fact, the main crux of the matter to them is that he is inciting the public against the government.
Okay, inciting the public against the government. He's a traditional ruler. Yes. He has a right to his opinion. Are you saying that he doesn't have the right to have that opinion made public?
He deserves every right to make that opinion public.
So how then can he, because definitely as a traditional ruler, he has followers. How then can he make those opinions public without inciting, especially those opinions that are against government policies?
Yes, that is the where the Kano State government picked offense. You understand? For making those opinions public.
Okay.
So they had one, if you are listening to the commission, they said if he had come to talk to the governor, you know, in private, and address the governor, said, "Governor, this area, this other area, the other area, the other area, the other area, is where you didn't get it right. You would have done it this other way, this other way." They wouldn't have been having these issues with them, with him. You know, that is the issue they had with him, and not about what he's saying. From what I understood, the commissioner said. Then, if you also listen to Sanusi in one of his speeches, he said that he has tried to restrain himself from making some of those things public, but he could not. And at a point, he stopped receiving public invitations.
Okay.
He began to dodge public invitations because he cannot go there and see things go wrong and not say it. That is the man deposed Emir Sanusi, Lamido Sanusi, is.
Okay.
That is the man he still remains till tomorrow. Look, nobody should rule him off. More is still to come. If I know Sanusi, Lamido Sanusi, he will unleash more.
Okay.
Cannot cage him. He will say his mind.
Now, it comes a very big question will come here now, that the role of the traditional ruler in politics, because with complications in the relationship of the governor of Kano State, Ganduje, and it was clear that Sanusi and Ganduje stood far apart from each other in the last general elections. Talking about last year, government officials publicly accused the monarch of supporting opposition People's Democratic Party against the incumbent All Progressives Congress, APC. The Emir did not deny any of those accusations, while the PDP supporters made every move to show their solidarity with him. But by the end of the election, which was won by Mr. Ganduje, Mr. Ganduje made no pretense that he was going after the Emir. So, one question. Remember, the government hurried the legislation, tearing up the once flourishing Kano Emirate into five with additional first-class Emirs that stood at par with the Emir of Kano. Well, so, one will be asking, what should be the position of a traditional ruler in politics as far as representation is concerned?
If you ask Uchaguru, in my honest opinion,
yes,
traditional rulers should play politics but not partisan politics.
How possible? Because you definitely go for
look at why I said not partisan politics.
Okay.
Now, any society that does not play politics cannot develop.
Okay.
Any society that does not play, mark my word, any society that does not play politics cannot develop, because politics is the major driver of economy, as we speak to that, and every other sector. Because you elect politicians into office for them to go and work for the development of the society. So if you don't make conscious effort of getting the right people in positions of authority, the society will continue to go backwards. And the autonomous communities as we have them today, the emirates as they are today, all the kingdoms, all those domains, they are the grassroots communities whereby our development should begin from and extend towards the other areas. You understand?
Okay.
So when the people in the autonomous communities, in our rural settlements, in our grassroots settlements, when they begin to feel the impact of governance, then the society will be better for it. So that is why I said every traditional ruler, remember, the traditional ruler is the custodian of the culture tradition and tradition of a people. And by implication, they are also the chief security officers of certain of their domain.
Uche, you will agree with that. Whatever decision a traditional ruler takes, affect the national and the social political landscape. I mean, the social political landscape of that community. And you will agree with me that it's maybe right. Okay, is it right for a traditional ruler to support maybe one political party to make his political impact known, like to make whatever he's supporting to make it known to the public? That's where the big question
is where I will not support any traditional ruler. Whenever any traditional ruler engages in partisanship, that is where he lost me.
How do you want the community to develop if they do not engage in partisan politics?
The communities can engage in partisan politics, but the traditional ruler himself must be seen to be apolitical.
Okay.
Now, look at what I mean. A traditional ruler is supposed to, any politician that comes to his domain, he's supposed to receive that politician, irrespective of the political party he or she belongs to, irrespective of whether the opposition or the ruling party, he must receive that politician in accordance with the and state what the problems and the expectations of his people are to the politician, and then they tell the politician, yes. This is you are in my domain. My community needs so so and so things. We have so and so problems within my community. If you happen to win this election, these are the needs of my community. But it would be very wrong for a traditional leader to come out and say my domain will vote for you. No. My kingdom will vote for you. No. My autonomous community will vote for you. No. You don't have to speak for the generality of your because there are diverse political as well.
Are you saying that the stigma that is on ground now against Mr. Sanusi is coming because he made a move that went against Mr. Ganduje when he was vying for a second time?
Let me note this. The problem between Ganduje and Sanusi has started long before 2019 election.
Okay.
Their problem have started long before 2019 election. Wankwaso that brought him into office. What party was Wankwaso?
He was formerly with the PDP.
When he brought him into office. So you can now note that it is not about the party. It's not about the party in power or the party that he compared against, if there's anything like that, but it's about what he perceived as things not being done right in Kano State.
Okay,
you understand? But it is not about persons, but it's about a system.
But do you agree that his dethronement is political?
100% political.
Is it about 2023?
It's not about 2023.
All right, let's head straight to the phone lines because some persons are advocating for him to delve into politics ahead of 2023 in view of his profile and wide appeal. Let's go straight to the phone lines. What do you make of the deposed Emir of Kano? What do you make of his dethronement? I'm talking about Muhammadu Sanusi II, and of course the role of traditional rulers in politics. It's a very, very important conversation we should engage in. 0808-182-6949. You can also drop messages on 0906-510-8289. It is the platform right here on Flow 94.9 FM. Good morning to you.
Hello, good morning.
Yes, good morning.
Your guest, I say good morning, sir.
Good morning, my brother.
My name is Mr. Shijoki from Bendi Road.
You're welcome.
Thank you. This morning, I just want to add my voice to what we are discussing this morning. If I may say, I will just go straight to the point and made it clear that it's very, very wrong for most of our traditional rulers to engage themselves in politics. Because I believe that when you are being elected the traditional ruler, you are there for all the parties. But now, the value is because Nigeria traditional rulers does not follow what they promise people. And that is why most of the times, they keep on having problems. I believe that Sanusi belongs to CDP. And I would never, nobody would convince me that Sanusi respects, always respects his traditional title. So, but on the other side, I am begging the Kano State government not to take it too much personal like that. Let them consider the man and see if they can reverse their distance. Against the traditional ruler.
All right.
So I want to use the opportunity to beg our traditional ruler in Akasi, where we are now. Let them leave politics. If they want to play politics, let them resign and come fully into politics. Because right now, if you go to Europe, you see how.
Your time is up, Mr. Chidi. Okay, your time is up. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hello, good morning to you. We lost that 0808-182-6949. 0811-605-2949. Good morning.
Good morning, man.
You're welcome. Good morning.
Good morning, the guests in the studio.
Yeah, good morning, my brother.
My name is Robert Collins from Omaya.
You're welcome.
The issue of the former Emir, he has a lot of controversies, like the analysts in the house trying to point out something. The rascality in the negative aspect and the positive aspect. You trace from the former, his grandfather, you see. Sometimes Spanish.
Hello.
So I think yes, I'm. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah. So at times you notice that foundation play a lot in our life, and besides, the role of the traditional rulers should be spelled out very well, even in our constitution, so that the governments and the traditional rulers, they should know their part to play, not to mingle with the traditional affair. And see, what is happening? I don't understand. Can they remove the let's say Oba of Lagos? In the way they are doing in the Kano, can they remove maybe the global of Emir? All those things you should consider. Apart from removing him, the issue of banishing him has gone into his fundamental human rights. Why are you removing someone from his own state, his own house, to go and keep in a local place or not even know? So all those should be abolished, and let us live as if we are in the 21st century. All this barbaric kind of tradition doesn't help at all. And the rule.
All right. We got your opinion before the network dropped you off. Good morning to you.
Hello, Precious.
Hello, good morning.
Hello, Precious.
Okay, that's a wrong number. Thank you. Good morning to you.
Hello, good morning.
Yes, good morning.
My name is Vincent Ekeke. I'm born and raised in Omaha.
You're welcome, Sir Vincent.
Thank you. On the issue of Sanusi's disownment and banishment by the governor or government of Kano State.
Yes.
I wish to state categorically clear here that firstly, it is clear that traditional rulers are not supposed or allowed to involve or participate in party politics. Rather, by their position, they are traditional fathers. They receive and welcome all political party members, advise them, and hear from them. But on the other side, if you see what is happening in this country, even the politicians, the incumbent politicians flood them on their side at a situation whereby you see traditional rulers making public statements, openly siding a political party. That is completely wrong. Now, issue of dethronement of Sanusi, yes, the governor has the power because he appointed him, or let me say, he was under the payment of the government of Sanusi.
Yeah, quickly wrap up your thoughts,
he
please.
Can fire him. But finally, the issue of banishment,
yes,
that law is outdated.
Okay.
You cannot banish him because right. Nigeria will no longer operate that law.
All right. Thank you for your opinion. Good morning to you.
Yeah, hello. Good morning, Michael.
Yes, good morning.
Yeah, good morning to your great minister there.
Good morning.
Yeah, I am Michael.
Okay. I think we lost him there. Hello, good morning to you.
Hello, good morning, Mike.
Yes, good morning.
Good morning, the gentleman at the studio there.
Yeah, good morning.
Yeah, this is Baba Ganas from Omotum National Group.
You're welcome, Baba Ganas.
Yeah, in respect of what is happening in Kano, it's politics.
Okay.
But the annoyance to banish the man from his own community is against the woman's rights. For banishing him, you have to obey the government who put you into that post. And the royal fathers, they're not supposed to oppose in anything politics.
Okay.
They're supposed to deal with that. Now politics is happening in Kano. There's nothing like that.
Okay. Thank you, Baba Ganas. Many of the respondents are saying that, traditional rulers should stay away from politics. And you're also saying that they should stay away
from partisan
politics. Like partisan you said, partisan politics.
But telling them to stay away from politics generally is tantamount to growth of their domains.
Okay.
People are saying that Sanusi a campaign for PDP. In 2019 election, I don't see it from that angle. That is a PDP member. Do they remember that Sanusi campaigned against PDP in 2015?
You won't put it as campaign. He spoke on a controversial money during Jonathan's government.
What is campaign? What is campaign?
He spoke against a particular amount of money when he was the central bank governor.
What do you do campaigning?
Uche,
what do you do campaigning?
Okay, you call it campaign. you call it campaign.
Many saw it. He spoke to the appeal of the people.
Many saw it as campaign then because they were expecting him as the CBN governor to be loyal to the president.
Not really. What really happened was that the figures was banding us at that time.
Okay.
We are proven to be not really correct.
Okay.
So it turned out to be false allegations against the president as at that time. And again, for somebody at his stature to come and begin to allay false allegations against the sitting government, it gives an impression that he has turned a partisan and against what the oath of his office was at the time.
Now, the big stick was welded by the government, Kano State government. But many are asking that, is it proper for traditional rulers to be answerable to the government, to state government? There are different institutions, state government and of course traditional institutions. So is it proper for traditional institutions to be answerable to the government, maybe the federal government or the state government or the local government? Is it proper?
Given the type of politics, our political structure,
yes,
they run in this nation today, our constitution permits that it is the state governments that will hand over staff of office to you as a traditional ruler.
Okay.
So, given that background, you must be answerable to the state government. Again, coming to ask if traditional institutions are supposed to be answerable to state governments or not. I think that question should be answered by the constitution.
Okay.
And it has always been answered by the constitution.
Back in the day, I know the traditional ruler's seat is seen as an exalted position, like a sacred position.
Even up to now, it is still a sacred position.
Okay. A sacred position being answerable to the state government, maybe answerable to the governor of a state. That's the big question there.
Yes. Are you aware that in the present structure, that what we have that present generals of the of our autonomous communities are the people that the government interfaces directly with when it comes to issues of development?
Okay.
Are you aware? You understand? Now, because the role of the traditional rulers are only to maintain the custodians of our culture and tradition.
Okay.
That is where their roles end. Understand? They are custodians of culture and tradition. And also remember that whatever they use to sustain and maintain their offices and traditional rulers have been provided by the government.
So
they don't have any other source of income.
It is proper for them to be answerable.
And you cannot also allow them not to be regulated. There should be regulation in all we do. If you allow them to be regulated, they can stand up one morning and do anything they want to do.
We have someone on the line. Hello, good morning to you.
Good morning.
Yes, good morning. Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning, my brother.
Charles.
You're welcome, yes. Charles. Can you speak up, Charles, please?
Yes, what has happened to
okay.
Okay. Is nothing but the flight of the traditional system. I tend to buy some of the points spent there by Tuesday. But I want to say that the whole thing is caused by the type of politics and top of politicians we have in Nigeria. People not trying to respect other institutions. They want their own institutions to be respected. You know the work of the traditional rulers. It's like a father that should accept or welcome every political party. Tell that party the problem of his of our community. Then you have to learn that these politicians don't allow these traditional rulers to do what they're supposed to do as traditional rulers. What has happened to Sanusi is what is happening everywhere. It is even worse here in Niger State. That is why today the traditional institution in my state, Abia, has lost their value, their credibility. Because the situation here, even the chairman of the traditional United States will be given a vehicle by the government or the ruling party.
How is it wrong for traditional rulers to receive, you know, to get gifts from to receive gifts from the government?
No. That's what I said.
Okay.
From the executive. Mm. That does not mean that executive do not allow the half of assembly to function. That is what I meant by giving respect to every institution. So the question is that the position just go to ask these people. And if you don't do it, next year they take their office. That is why today every community leader in Niger wants to say something about their staff to the appointment of their community. Mm. And then you have once that you come to a community, once that
all right, quickly wrap up your thoughts, Charles.
So what I like I said, it is the fight of the Nigeria. And I say that our lawmakers, you must do something to protect the traditional system.
Thank you for your contribution, Charles. Hello, good morning to you.
Morning, Michael.
Good morning.
Morning, Mr. Chaguru.
Good morning, my brother.
Who's the man? I'm calling from Omaya.
Welcome.
Traditional institution is supposed to be an independent institution. But unfortunately, with the way Nigerian constitution runs, most traditional rulers are loyal to the governor of the state. Most, because they earn and they receive the staff of honor from the governor, and they receive their salaries from the governor. So that is why they cannot say go the other way against their own opinion. But they say that they are not supposed to be partisan, and they are human beings. They are political animals. They human beings. We all are political animals. So they have a real right to play politics, but most times it should be in tandem with the state of the governor or the development of the community. So what happens to Fazi to be, I saw it as a karma, because Jonathan, 10 Emirates and when others used him against Jonathan. They used him against PDP, but unfortunately, it comes out, maybe due to his nature, he always voices out when he sees things going wrong. But now he's trying to talk. The people that used him decided to resign him.
All right.
Talk about the traditional right, they're not supposed to banish him, but one of the agents in Norway called yesterday in one of your sisters' the radio station and said that that has been their, and then Yero Danladi, he spoke on air and said that that has been their tradition, that they will banish him, they send him to Sanusi just for security reasons. So Mr. Sanusi should go and beg Jonathan Jonathan will forgive him. Thank you.
Okay, that's your angle, saying maybe he's been punished for sins against Jonathan. That's your angle to the whole crisis. We'll call it a royal shocker in Kano. Hello, good morning to you.
Hello, good morning, my sir.
Good morning to you.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
I am Mr. Lofman from Odemaya.
Welcome.
All right. My own contribution is that if wherever any rule with a traditional law is included in policy, the rule should not be moved to policy. Whatever any rule, whatever any political party that the traditional law player should do by themselves, and anything that they contribute should be on themselves, not anybody taking it in public. And you know, the governor of Sanusi, he started from inherited the thing from his father. So as the thing is going on, that's how the thing is going on. So wherever anything you say, that should not be involved with, that's my point there.
Okay, thank you for your take. Hello, good morning to you.
Hello, good morning, Michael.
Good morning, Radio Senator.
Yeah, this is good morning, our guest.
Yeah, good morning.
Yeah, this is Radio Senator calling from Government College in Moya.
Welcome.
See, what is happening in our Nigeria society is violation of Nigeria Constitution. It's clear. In the First Republic, the chiefs have to say, the chiefs are involved in politics. That is the First Republic Constitution. But in Second Republic Constitution, they were excluded. They were removed totally. Nothing like governor paying them money. It's not there. It's unconstitutional for crying it
out. Just a moment, Radio Senator. Yeah, how do you expect the traditional institutions to be functioning without getting their monies? I mean, without being funded by the state government.
That is exactly what I'm telling you. The constitution made it clear. Hence, they be in the various communities and villages. It is the villages' function for them to take care of their traditional rulers. It is not the government, because he who pays the fine for the 72. That was why they were removed. Then before, in 1960 to 1966, we have what we call a Council of Peace in the House of Assembly. But immediately in the Second Republic, they saw the role they play. They were party partisans. So they were removed. Then they neutralized them so that they would be free. And okay. Then whoever they want to advise, they advise him without looking at whether you are the governor or the president. They advise him the way you should accordingly. So that is, the constitution did not allow the governor or the president to give money or to pay any money to them. They are doing against the constitution for crying it loud. And that is exactly what is happening there.
All right, Radio Senator, you have to wrap up your thoughts. Your time is up.
To do. Well,
all right.
Thank
you very much. Uche Agoru, we've come to the end of the program. Many thanks for being part of the program this morning, and many thanks for your analysis on the show this morning.
Yes, Michael, it's been a wonderful time, and I still want to remind people that this is not strange. What has happened is not strange. It's been happening.
And
even
the Oba
of Benin that they've been citing, the Oba of Benin was at a point suspended by Captain Tony Onyarugulem.
It's true.
So nobody is above the laws of the land. You know, that is what the means, you know.
All right. Thank you very much, Uchiha Guru, for being part of the program this morning.
Thank you very much.
Thanks to the producer of the program, Samson Eze. Don't forget, this edition of the program will be on our YouTube later on today at Flow FM TV on YouTube. Thank you very much. The program returns on Friday. My name is Michael Oni.
At Flow 94.9 FM, we've got conducive and well-secured environment for business, high-tech video studio, a state-of-the-art production studio. You can also listen live on www.flow949fm.com and watch our videos on YouTube at Flow FM TV. Flow 94.9 FM, not just radio, but a complete broadcasting house.